Hey everybody. Okay, so went live twice. Hey everybody. It's Jeff Lafferty. This is the weekly art cast with Scott Circland.
How's it going?
And Kevin Cross, who's actually not here, and we got the Kevin Cross replacement, which is Mike Fleming.
Hello everyone.
I should have said the infamous Mike Fleming.
I don't think either one fits. I don't think so, man. I don't think I'm any kind of anything yet. I still got a lot of work to do.
Yeah, sorry, my stupid video started out after I told you how not to do that. Okay. I don't know if everybody remembers Mike, but he was on the show a long time ago when we were doing the morning shows for a little while, and then he took off. Like an awesome sculptor.
All that good stuff. Jeff. That's very nice of you. Probably the nicest thing you've ever said to me, actually. I was just kidding. Really? Yeah, thanks, man.
Well, anyway, tonight, I don't know, we don't really have a topic, but I thought we might end up talking about some animation, because since Mike does stop motion also, and I'm doing it. But before that, I wanted to ask you, Scott, like how the con went and all that kind of thing.
It went pretty well. You know, it wasn't like in terms of sales, it wasn't like gangbusters or I made my table back and then some. But I'm probably going to do a video and moving forward, like what I'm going to do, going to change some things around. But yeah, there was a lot. I did take away a lot of new ideas and things. Like some of the things that I changed really seemed to work. I noticed some of them didn't. So yeah, I don't know. But the con itself was. I didn't get the numbers back, but it seemed like it was probably record attendance, because usually they'll have like the preview night on Thursdays.
Yeah.
And I had never seen it like that on a Thursday ever. It looked like a Saturday. It was crazy.
Really?
But it didn't seem like people were buying as much, even though there was more people there. Like you kind of watch and you see how many people are carrying some, merchandise and things like that. And sometimes people put stuff in backpacks, so you can't really always tell. It didn't look like people were carrying around as much stuff. So I don't know. I'd be curious to. I was pretty busy the whole time, though. I mean, as far as like. For the most part, mostly it was just me. Every once in a while, my girlfriend would show up for a little bit and kind of relieve me, and I try to go out and check some things out. But I didn't get a chance to talk to some of the other exhibitors to kind of find out how they did. But one of the things I think I might do is next year, instead of getting, because I kind of upgraded to the booth, and one of the issues with that is because. At least at Phoenix Comic Con, the way it's set up, you've got the Artist Alley tables, right? And then you've got the booths. And the booths are, for the most part, the booths are mostly like vendors, people that are reselling stuff like pop vinyls and, whatever, whether they're selling like lightsabers or things like that. But it's, most of it is like things that you would find like at a store, like resellers or whatever. I guess the lightsaber people make their own lightsabers and everything. There's some of that stuff, but there's a lot of people just selling like toys and comics and stuff that they have collections of or like a store. So the problem with that booth area is I don't think people really understood that I had created all this stuff.
Yeah.
I think they thought that I'm just selling it, So I don't know if that's the difference between an Artist Alley, I assume in Artist Alley they know that you're the creator. I mean yeah. You have to, and if you're going to exhibit in the Artist Alley, you have to be, you can't resell stuff. You have to be the exhibitor. I mean, you have to be the creator of whatever you're selling. So, like I can get two tables in Artist Alley and have pretty much the same amount of space, a little less maybe, but for way less than what the booth costs. So it's getting harder and harder to, I mean, the competition is, getting harder and everything. So it's harder to make a decent profit at some of these shows. So I'm kind of reevaluating that, and I'm actually going to start I'm looking at exhibiting in other types of venues other than comic conventions. So, but yeah. I don't want to make it a whole, you know. I do want to talk about conventions like later. Like, so tomorrow for my day job, we're having a big convention because we're unveiling our new catalog. And even though that's kind of a it's an entirely different, like, you know, kind of product. Yeah. I'm curious how that goes because I want to see what I can take away from that. Because anyone that kind of knows me, and I'm very big on presentation. And so is, like, my work. Like, we've been prepping for this thing for, like, ever. And, like, the stuff that they do is, like, pretty impressive. So I'm curious to see how this goes and if I could have some takeaway. And then after that, I want to do some more of the, like, the pro versus con videos where I talk about the conventions and things like that. And I also, you know, and maybe another couple episodes down, next time I host or something, maybe I'll do a little episode on conventions and things like that, but you know, yeah. There's a lot to talk about. Well, but you know, I'm curious since Mike's on, and I haven't really talked to Mike in a while, and I'm curious what's going on with your animation and everything. So, and plus, I think last time around, I think I talked way too much. So I want to kind of sit back and
you know. Yeah, actually, you just filled up all the time we had, man.
Okay, sorry. you can't ask me a question like that, Jeff, because I'll just keep talking.
Well, that's what we do on this show, right? Yeah, so, yeah. That's what the people show up for.
So
that's great. That sounds awesome. So, like, do you all just want to start talking about the cons then, or do you want to, like?
No, I want to hear about the animation and the sculpting and stuff and why you're building the snowman.
Yeah, let's go to that. What are you doing, Mike?
I actually don't know what I'm doing yet.
Okay.
I didn't have a plan or anything. I just kind of found out about this a little bit ago and kind of just throwing this all together. So I'm thinking about making like some sort of pig that's kind of laughing or something. I don't know. I'm not sure yet. It might turn into a frog or maybe some sort of gecko.
Is that usually how you start? You just kind of start sculpting and then it kind of takes its own shape? Or do you typically kind of know in advance what you're going to start with?
I always have an idea.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I don't know. I try to go in with a plan, and like if anyone ever asks, I try to always say, oh, yeah, that's exactly what I intended. But that's not normally the case.
Yeah.
But I think it's just going to be a pig, is all. Like a pig, like laying back, kind of chuckling.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying a new style of sculpting in a new material. So, and also these are like way bigger than I'm used to sculpting. Like you seen that frog I was doing.
Yeah.
Like that's the biggest thing I've ever sculpted ever. So I'm trying to go a little bit bigger and change my casting process a little bit and try to make things a little bit cheaper to somewhere.
What are you going to sculpt that thing in? You said you're going to change your material.
Yeah, like to do this all in Super Sculpt, it would take a lot, or wax or anything like that. So I'm using this stuff called Wed Clay.
Oh, okay.
It's stands for Walter Elias Disney. So I guess it's like some clay that he kind of came up with a long time ago, I guess. So I don't know the whole story on it, but I just found out about it, and I'm giving it a shot. It's like $10 for 25 pounds of it, and if you keep it moist, it stays pliable and wet. It kind of feels like something out of a riverbed, which I'm sure is not too far off of where it comes from.
Yeah. That's pretty neat. I've seen that stuff. I never have bothered or used it. Easily use the Super Sculpey. But you were using that really cool, was it wax or was it clay? That stuff that you could just like shape into all kinds of crazy, you know, pieces of armature and everything. And
oh yeah, the wax. Yeah, like I'd make a mold, I'd start it in Sculpey and then I'd transfer it over to the wax and like do detail work.
Yeah, that thing's really cool. And all those little guys and stuff.
There's the little guy that's
standing in that. How come you're stopping using that stuff?
I'm not stopping. I'm just, it would take a long time to do, and it's also expensive to do the entire, like, something big like that. I want to start trying to get into bigger, you know, I just want to test that field out a little bit, kind of see some opportunity there, and I want to see if I can capitalize on it. I see a lot of people, like, selling concrete statuary and stuff, and they're always just stealing each other's molds, and I mean, nobody, like, I've never even met or seen a sculptor actually sculpting those things. They're just always stealing molds from everywhere, like online. I've been researching a little bit, and they'll make the molds for you, and then they'll ship the mold to you, but they're just, like, stealing the sculpts. So I'm gonna just try to do some originals in concrete, and, I mean, they sell like hotcakes. Like, at least that's what I've been seeing, so.
Oh, really? Okay.
That's the goal for this project.
That's cool. Changing up the products a little bit. Nah, I get that.
I still like the little guys, and I'm definitely going to keep going with that, but yeah. You know, I'm just going to switch it up a little bit and, you know, try it out.
Yeah. I remember, like, I had some clay that I really liked. So I like Sculpey because I can, like, cook it and then, you know, sand on it and stuff.
Yeah.
But the, I got some of this clay from, like, that Monster Maker's place. I think they called it Monster Clay. It was like their brand of clay.
Oh,
that
yeah.
Stuff was like, you ever tried that stuff?
No, actually, I have not. I've heard so much about it, and it's like a fantastic product, but I've never actually bought some. I have some ordered right now, so hopefully it'll come in this week.
Oh, that's cool.
Definitely want to give that a shot. You can like melt it down, and you can do a lot with it, right? It's kind of like, like the consistency of Super Sculpey, kind of.
Yeah, I mean, it's like working with it, though. It's got a lot more elasticity, kind of, you know what I mean? You can, like, bring it out, like, really far and stuff, and it'll stay together. And then, I think you're right about the melting down. I think that I remember seeing that in their little brochure, because they just sent me, like, a little sample of it. But it was really nice, you know? I think I could actually sculpt, because I always feel like I can't sculpt something to a finished thing without cooking it and then, like, messing with it. Yeah. But, like, that stuff I might be able to, because it kind of would hold detail so well and stuff, you know? So.
Have you ever tried casting anything with it? Like a little part or anything like that?
Oh, no, I never did try that. I'm so bad at casting that, you know.
Really?
I don't know why. It's just, like getting my head wrapped around it. Make it work, actually. It's not so much getting my head wrapped around it, but it's like making it work, you know?
Yeah.
Just the other guys do it, and they pull out like the awesome thing like you do, you know, all this detail and stuff. But then like when I do it, it seems like all my detail gets like rounded over or something. So.
I don't mean to laugh.
But I've never tried. Yeah.
It's just that happens to me a lot, so.
Does it? I never tried it with like real, like the molding silicone though. I usually would do it with the plaster.
I noticed so. One time you did it with like acrylic latex caulk, right? The caulking.
Well that I don't remember doing a mold out of that. I tried making some faces, that could move, you know.
Yeah.
So I used it as the stuff inside it, and then I kind of abandoned that idea for, like, the replacement faces eventually.
Okay. Maybe that's what I'm thinking of then.
I think so. But that, you know, like, that caulk is so, it's not as stretchy as normal silicone. It's kind of like, I mean, like, because I got some of the dragon skin, and I've cast some stuff out of that, and that stuff is, like, you know, crazy flexible, you know? And, like the caulk is like it's really stiff, really. It's not that great.
Plus it takes like you gotta let that dry for like a week, don't you?
The caulk stuff?
Yeah.
Well now if you mix water in it, that's actually what like does the chemical reaction, I guess, in like just normal caulk.
Yeah.
Like the humidity. If you put some water in that stuff will dry like, you know, and it'll dry thick too. You can have a block of it like that, it'll cure all the way through. So.
Very cool.
Yeah.
So how is the stop motion coming along?
It's going good. I'm actually animating now, so that's taken a while, but I keep saying that maybe next week I'll have it done, but you know, I don't know, maybe next week. every time I go in there and I shoot something, it takes longer, but I've got like three scenes shot now.
And, holy crap, man, that's awesome. Like final scenes?
Not scenes. I mean, three just shots, basically. Not full scenes. I didn't mean to say that. Yeah. So, it's like, I think I got 45 seconds, basically.
Jeez, that's still a lot of time, man. That's awesome. I definitely want to see that.
Yeah. I'll show you what I got, like, afterwards, maybe.
All right, sweet. What are you working on, Scott? Are you just sitting there?
No, I'll switch over to screen share in a minute. I did a you contributed. Thanks, by the way. So I ran the Kickstarter, and now I'm working on some card art for my trading cards that I'm going to include. So I just have
to... Oh, sweet. You hit that goal, that stretch goal?
Yeah, I did. I hit all the stretch goals, so...
That's awesome, man. Except for, congratulations.
After I hit the third one, I made a fourth one, which I didn't expect to hit, and I didn't, but that's all right. I was, you know... Yeah, it was like the last day anyway. Yeah, it was the last day, and they always say, you know, you gotta try to get something to keep people trying to contribute. So, but yeah.
Yeah.
So,
did you notice a big surge at the at the end?
It was definitely a good day, but it was. I think my core audience had already backed. So it was. There were a few people that I think just found out about it late. And I was just so busy with everything else prepping for the convention that I didn't get a chance to, like, because I was going to start emailing people just because the way Facebook works where not everyone even knows that you're, you know, they don't always see your posts. So I was going to do that, but I found that last day I was just, like, answering questions to people and just the regular posts that I was doing took up most of my time. So I didn't get it. I think I really could have. If I had that time, if I wasn't gearing up for the convention right after it, and if I had more time just to concentrate just on the Kickstarter, I probably could have pushed a little harder, but it's okay, because I more than met the goal that I wanted to and everything. So kind of like with Jeff with his, you know, once he met his goal, you know, he kind of backed off, but I'm sure if he pushed it, it could have got bigger, but sometimes you just like, well, I did what I set out to do, so...
I mean, that's great.
Yeah, I don't know if I could have got bigger.
You don't think so?
I just kind of felt lucky to get where I was, but I don't know.
Yeah, I remember yours, Jeff. That was like a few months ago now for the book.
I don't think it's been more than 2 months, but yeah.
Yeah, that's great, man. It's always cool seeing, you know, one of those things fund. I mean, I've been on the end of a lot of different ones, and I mean, it's cool to see, you know, your buddy's project fund for sure.
Yeah.
So have you done, you said you've been involved in Kickstarter before, Mike. Have you done one just yourself? Or were you just like partnered up with other people?
Usually it's always been a partner deal and, or I've done like figurines for one or like a short film or something like that.
Yeah, because, I mean, probably the last time we talked, we were even kicking around the idea of trying to come up with something for a Kickstarter or something, I think.
Yeah, with your monster mashes.
Yeah, that's right. That's right, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Kickstarters are fun. I mean, it's cool to hear that they work for people. And like, I've never actually been on the end of receiving any funds from one, like, personally, but... So I don't exactly know how Amazon, like how that whole payment thing works or how much taxes they take out. Like I hear so much stuff on that, it's hard to keep track of, you know, the truth.
Yeah, well, I haven't got the funds yet, so I don't know. Jeff would know though.
Yeah, Amazon doesn't take out any taxes. You just have to keep those back yourself.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but I think Amazon pretty much ends up with about 10%. I think it's like 5% for the credit cards, if I remember right. And then there's like another 5%, something else on top of that. So
that's all Amazon, or that's Kickstarter and Amazon together? I think it's anymore either. I think it's Stripe or something, some other thing. I don't think it's Amazon anymore.
When I backed both years, I think I had to go through Amazon.
Oh, was it? Oh, maybe it is. Okay.
I still have to sign in. Yeah. Well, Stripe's just kind of like PayPal or something. But
are they accepting PayPal yet?
No.
No. I had somebody ask if they did. It sounded like that was the more convenient way, so
we'd figure that out like years ago. I mean, there's got to be some reason why they're not.
Well, I think part of it is because you don't pay right away. Like usually with PayPal, you pay right away, but with the way Kickstarter is, you don't your credit card or whatever doesn't get charged until the thing funds. So, or even after, yeah, until it funds. So that might have something to do with why it doesn't work.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know why they won't go PayPal or they don't go PayPal. Might be because they're in competition.
Probably.
Yeah, I'm sure Kickstarter has like, or Amazon has Kickstock or something in Kickstarter or something like that.
Well, I think Amazon owns Kickstarter though, doesn't it?
Oh,
I thought
really?
It did. Maybe I'm completely wrong there.
I don't know.
That would make a whole lot of sense.
But yeah, I mean, you've been in like how many Kickstarters? Like you did, you ran an Indiegogo yourself. When we met, you had run one Kickstarter that failed, right? Failed to fund for a.
No, the only Kickstarter I ever ran like solo was the one we did together.
Yeah.
And then there was like an offshoot of that project that went to Indiegogo because we figured PayPal was like a better way to go.
Great idea to go with Indiegogo, and it just sucked. I do remember just feeling really bad about pushing you towards that.
Yeah, thanks for that.
Well, I just figured, I don't know. For some reason, I just thought, it made more sense, but man. You had a pretty. You almost got it on Kickstarter, and then I remember freaking Indiegogo didn't do anything.
No, I think Indiegogo did like. Maybe I'm thinking. It's been so long, man. That was like what six or 7 years ago now.
That was years ago, and then I remember you were like associated with like Justin Roche's Kickstarter, who's like another animator.
Yeah, I did the toys for his film.
Yeah.
I sculpted Flea and Dober for that, and that did really really well.
Yeah,
Yeah, that was awesome. That's definitely something people should go check out if you guys don't know about Justin and Shell. I mean that movie is just really cool.
Yeah.
And it's what a lot of people are trying to do with like their stop motion movies, and they've like actually did it, the whole thing, you know.
Yeah, they made two like independent films, basically for people that don't recognize them. They were just like little stop-motion cartoons, and one's called Gerald's Last Day, and what's the second one called? I can't remember.
I think it's just called Line.
Oh, it's called The Line, yeah. It's like a dog
or no,
alien
versus... They changed it to Dogonauts, that's what it was. Dogonauts. Enemy Line, I think is what it's called.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I did the... Here's actually one of them. Like, this is a clear cast of one of them, but... This is Little Dober.
Oh,
I don't have the painted ones right here, but this is the see-through, like, Ice Cube version.
That's cool.
That's neat.
Yeah, that was a really cool project. That was, like, a really rough, like, when we came up with the idea to do the little toys, I mean, I was working and everything, 12 or 13-hour days, and, like, I was coming home and working on these little guys at night, and I had to have it done, and, like... I don't know. I had to have both of them done in like inside of a week or.
Oh lordy.
Yeah, it was rough. But it was a lot of fun.
Yeah. Well, it's cool to see somebody make it work. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, try to like do like the indie movie thing and then actually get funded and all that. And he ended up getting like hired by Leica and works now on like for those movies, right? I think he's working on the new one they're putting out.
Kubo.
Yeah. And he worked on like Box Trolls and also Paranorman, right?
Yeah, Paranorman. Yeah, he's cool, definitely it's definitely helped. I mean, I don't think his wife ever worked on any of those, but I think she was offered a spot.
Really?
Yeah, but I think the kids and everything that she just wasn't able to, but I'm not exactly sure on that.
Yeah.
She's definitely super talented, though. Like, she's really good at making molds and...
Yeah, because they were, like, a team, and they built everything, like, together. And I guess he animated all of it? I don't know. Or did she animate some of it?
I'm pretty sure he did all the animation.
Yeah.
Oh, no, actually, a couple people came and helped out with a few shots.
Right.
A few famous animators.
I kind of remember that now. That's even been a while since all that was going on.
No, that's been, like... years and years ago, man. I used to love going to their site and seeing all the updates.
I know, that was cool. It's too bad that, in a way, that he did get hired, because it's like it kind of killed it.
Yeah, and
that
I think
was really awesome.
Yeah, I think right now he's actually working for some video game company.
Oh, really?
I don't even think he's working on the new, I think he was offered a spot, but he didn't take it.
Oh, really? Yeah. I guess I just assumed it, because I started seeing him, like, in some of the behind-the-scenes stuff, you know?
Yeah.
And I know I saw some pictures of him on, like, Paranorman. I think I saw some from Box Trolls, too, but not 100%.
Yeah, he's definitely in the behind-the-scenes videos on the DVD of Paranorman.
Yeah. That's pretty cool.
That's probably one of my favorite stop-motion movies in a long time.
Yeah, that's really good.
That is a cool one.
I saw they had some of the props and stuff and the figures, or what do you call them, puppets, or they had some at Universal Studios, like behind glass, and they had the van and everything. Oh, man, they really looked awesome.
Oh, really? That's awesome.
Yeah. I don't know if they still do. They probably have whatever, you know, they might have the Cubo or whatever the latest thing is, you know. I haven't been there in a while, but this was after Paranorman came out, and, man, it was really awesome to look at.
The one in California or Florida?
Yeah, this is the one in California. Oh, but nice. They probably have, you know, I'm sure they have something like that in Florida, too.
That's awesome.
I noticed Samurai Ox in the chat. He said that Indiegogo uses PayPal, but there are ways using PayPal that people can dispute their pledges and screw things up. So I guess he's meaning, like, that's why they don't use it with Kickstarter. And you know, since I sell tons of stuff, like on eBay and stuff, I do know that's true. With PayPal, you know, you have that buyer protection, which is a real pain in the ass because, you know, if somebody wants to screw with you, like after you do a commission or something, they can, like, tie your money up for quite a while. So maybe that's why they don't want nothing to do with PayPal. I didn't think about that.
Well, there's a comment under that from Jen M., and it says, I've seen bigger Kickstarters have PayPal, but the person has to do it separate from the site. So I guess, yeah, so I guess if you, there's a way, there's probably like a workaround or something you can do.
That's interesting.
I didn't even think about that. Oh, did you, so I was watching one of, I missed contributing to Jason Brubaker's Kickstarter, because I was like so busy with my own. I was going to do it and I didn't realize it ran out, but I guess there's something called, I forgot what it's called, it's something like Indiegogo Express or something weird like that, where after, even if you run like a Kickstarter, and if people, you know, who wanted to back it didn't get a chance to, Indiegogo does something where you can almost like, you kind of purchase it, like you can just contribute to an Indiegogo for the same thing and get that whatever it was. And you might not get all the extras and the tiers and things like that. But I thought that was interesting. I'll have to look into that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I know what you're talking about. They call that Indiegogo In Demand.
Okay, that sounds like, yeah, right.
Yeah, I've noticed a few, like Dragon's Lair, they switched from Kickstarter. They didn't fund on Kickstarter, and they went over to Indiegogo. And then after they did fund over there, they put it in Demand, and then people keep donating and donating.
Okay.
So,
like,
oh, okay.
I guess it's like it's an open-ended run on your campaign, I guess. I mean, because they're still making money on that thing.
Yeah, I think I was thinking about doing my own, but then I thought I heard something about it's probably only advantageous for like bigger Kickstarters or whatever, bigger campaigns. I don't remember why, but I seemed that was the takeaway.
That's interesting. It's almost like just setting up a store and just selling your stuff, but
kind of
like
Indiegogo. That's one thing I have to do, is I have to put a link to my, like, my store from the Kickstarter. I haven't done all that stuff yet. I've just been so busy, but, yeah, I got to get back to doing all the Kickstarter stuff and wrapping all that up. And I haven't got the, like I said, I haven't got the funds yet, but I'm trying to get a head start on some of this stuff, you know.
Yeah. What do you got? What do you got to do? You got to, you have a store on Kickstarter? What'd you say?
No. Well, I've got my own online store, and I got to put like, I won't, you know, once I get the comics printed, I want to put all that stuff up there. But I want to put a link to my store, so because you know, the one thing about Kickstarter is it's searchable, and people might find it. So if they find it, and it's already, you know, if the campaign's already over with, then there's a link. If they want to still get the comic, they can go to my store and get it.
Oh, okay. I see what you're saying. That's yeah, I mean that's a great way to advertise, I guess.
Well, people do find those little Kickstarters. I have people that actually find, you know, that old stop motion one every now and then, and you know, they'll come and ask what happened to the project, and you know, tell you that you should run another one or something, you know. So
you should take it over to Indiegogo, Jeff.
Yeah. Well, some people make it work on Indiegogo. How was I supposed to know it wasn't going to work?
No, I'm just kidding. I know they definitely have. They definitely do. I mean, I guess it's just if the product's good, it's going to work wherever. So.
Yeah, I think a lot of it is following. Do you know that there's like that one girl? I can't remember her name now, but does like the fan films for Doctor Who. There's stop motion. I think I might have showed it to you at one point.
Doctor Who.
No, you haven't seen that? It's pretty cool. I'll have to show you the link later. But yeah, it's all stop motion, little puppets, and she just does little fan-made films. And she's got like about 8 of them now. And huge following on YouTube. And then she like ran a couple Indiegogos and just like cleaned up.
Yeah, I have no idea what you're talking about. That sounds intriguing.
Yeah. And they're pretty good. What
you said it's on Doctor Who, so what is it, like copyrighted stuff?
No, it, you know, just like us, fan art, right? It's just, yeah, she just makes them fan films, you know what I mean? So they're not like official or anything, and they're just real short, you know, like 6 minutes or something. And like, she just kind of has, like each one kind of has like a different doctor, you know, there's like a bunch of different Doctor Who's, you know.
So. Yeah, I actually don't know much about that show at all, but so they're all done in stop motion?
They're all stop motion, yeah. They little puppets, like, you know, cloth. I don't think there's any, like, claymation in it. Like, stick-on mouths, awesome. I'm pretty sure. Yeah, it's really cool. It's actually really cool.
Yeah, man, I'm definitely interested in that. And I'm glad to hear she's, like, you know, she's doing well with that. So you're saying it's mostly just because of her following on YouTube and from the videos?
I think so. I mean, you know, I don't know. It could just be because she's doing Doctor Who also, but she's got a big YouTube following. And then, you know, I don't know what her last or Indiegogo went, but I'm pretty sure it was like over 20 grand kind of a thing. You
Holy
know?
Crap. Yeah.
So, yeah, she did real well.
That's awesome.
But I'm sure it's just, you know, because she's got that following, she takes over to Indiegogo. She probably could do just as well on Kickstarter, you know.
Yeah. So, do you know if she's doing any of that on-demand stuff, like after one ends and...
I'm sorry, what?
I was just saying, do you know if she's doing any of that on-demand, like after it ends, she keeps it going to collect more funding?
I don't think so, but I'm not sure. I haven't been back since that last one, so I haven't really paid any attention, but... So, like, I don't know, I was just reading the chat, sorry, I didn't mean to, like, zone out, but this Gen M said Dragon's Lair added and changed a lot on Indiegogo, so I think they learned their lesson from Kickstarter. So.
Their Kickstarter, they made a lot of mistakes when they launched that thing.
I remember seeing the first video, and it was, like, some sort of play. It really had nothing to do with the game at all.
That was the pro. That was the first problem. Yeah. So.
Okay. All right. I never got a chance to go over to the Indiegogo, but I was following. Like, I follow Don Bluth on Facebook, and he was always posting like little videos and stuff. But I never actually went over to the actual page. I don't think.
Yeah.
But I remember his like new video was like much better. Actually explained what was happening and.
Yeah, that first one was horrid. Which, you know, you'd think, like, the Dragon Lair game, it's, like, no problem. But then I think they were trying to get, like, $200,000 or something, weren't they?
They're asking for $500,000 for, and they were only going to do a short little teaser to go pitch to other companies. And I thought that was, like, man, that's, I mean, $500,000. I know that's a lot of work, but, like, I think the teaser was only going to be, like, a minute or two of actual animation for the movie.
Wow.
So you weren't even going to, like, guaranteed to see a movie at the end. You were just helping them make the pitch.
Yeah.
And then they wanted, like, $20 million or something for the movie.
Jeez.
Well, I mean, that kind of animation is expensive. I mean, I imagine now, I would have to imagine that it's cheaper now, you know, I mean, just with all the new technologies and ways to speed up things than it probably used to be, like, but I don't know. I mean, you guys know more about animation, but I just remember, you know, I remember when I used to work in, like, film and stuff, anytime we had to quote somebody for animation, it was, you know, thousands and thousands of dollars a second, so.
Yeah. Well, and that's the thing about Don Bluth. He's, like, into that old-school animation, so even though there's, like, a lot of new technology. Of course, I'm sure that, like, you know, there still has to be a lot of stuff that would speed it up, though. You know, just with, like, the digital workflows and stuff.
I mean, Dragon's Lair itself was, like, the first computer, like, game. I mean, so, I mean, he's definitely willing to...
No, that's true.
you know, change it up or whatever. But, I mean, they definitely have the pedigree to make it happen. I mean, they know definitely what it takes. I mean, they've done tons of movies together.
Yeah, well, I would have loved to have seen it. I mean, or see a Dragon Lair movie. I mean, you know, Secret of Nim and all that stuff. I love that, man.
Yeah, man, it's fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was just going to say, it did fun on Indiegogo, didn't it? So we'll at least get to see, like, some test animation or that trailer, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And that'll be cool. What are you working on, Scott? Are you still working on the those little robots that you were snapping earlier?
That was just for fun. I was, you know, on my lunch hour at work, I was doing a sketch, but let's see. So yeah, right now, I mean, I gotta kind of regroup. The next thing I'm gonna do is really start to focus on my store and getting all that in order and getting some really nice photo product shots of my you know, merchandise and everything, and trying to really promote that and, you know, concentrate on the SEO and try to make both my store Envy store, which is attached to my website, and then also an Etsy store, see if I can really concentrate on that and start bringing in some online sales. I'm going to look, maybe, I had one before and I wasn't happy with it, but I'm going to look at maybe getting another Cintiq or Cintiq-like tablet and see if I can speed up the comic book process. And then I'm going to, like, finally, like, sit down and try to figure out Manga Studio and then start on Young and the Dead 4. So those are my next two kind of big things that I'm going to do. So after I... you know, after I get the Kickstarter stuff out and everything.
That's cool.
But right now...
Are you already all done with the Kickstarter? Like, all the stuff you have to do?
There's just minor stuff. The book is done, so I just need to send it out to the printer. I had some advanced copies that I had done, because it's all print-on-demand, that I brought to the comic convention, and I still have some left over, so I need to figure out how much more I need to get. I need to, you know, it's already done, but then I need to do, like, the mini comic versions, the artist editions. And there's only a few of those that I think backers, you know, backed for those, so I'll do those. And then I got to finish these trading cards. I had to do a little more work on the 3D print, but most of the stuff's done. It's just some minor tweaks and then just getting it all out to the printer and then just fulfilling everything, you know. So I imagine, I'm guessing next week I'll probably get the funds. I don't know, but so I want to try to get as much stuff done before I get that, because I want to get it out as soon as possible, you know.
Yeah.
So what's the holdup on the funds? Is it just
Oh, that's just the way it is. Yeah, it always takes a couple weeks before you get the funds. So it's not really, and I had anticipated that because I knew I would wrap up the Kickstarter and then I would have the Phoenix, then the next week I'd have Phoenix Comic Con, and then this week I have the convention for my day job. And then after that, then I'd kind of go back, and by then I had the funds and I can start getting stuff out to the printer and finishing up whatever like artwork I need to do. And so it's fine. I mean, I'm not like waiting by my email for the funds to come in or whatever, or a notice for my funds to come in.
Yeah. I don't remember what mine, whatever they said, I can't remember, because I thought they said like 2 weeks to 4 weeks or something, or 2 weeks to a month.
Oh, really? It could
be. I think so, yeah. But it was like on the, whatever the last day of that time frame was, like that's the day the money dropped in.
Oh, really? So, yeah, so, I mean, even if I could, because I have money that I earned from the convention and everything,
yeah.
I could start getting stuff printed now if I want. I just want to start, like, I want to have all these cards done, for one, and then, I mean, some of them are going to different places, like, Kablam's totally separate, so I could probably send that stuff out, like, whenever. I gotta tally up how many I need, and then there's a couple of the printers. I still need to find out who to do the stickers. I meant to talk to Gazbot, because he had stickers. I don't know if he priced them around. But I've got some stickers I'm going to include, so I have to find out where the best place to go to get those are. And I'm still trying to figure out who to do the trading cards. I might have to cut them myself because for the short run that I'm doing, I don't know that I can find a place that'll do them, you know, economically, you know, the way I need. Plus, it seems like any place that does, like, cards, it's always playing cards and with the rounded corners, and I don't want rounded corners, and I also don't want, a lot of places do glossy front and back, and I don't want glossy front and back. I want like semi-gloss on the front and like matte on the back, because all the old cards, that's the way they were, like the back sides were you know, there was no gloss or anything on it, so yeah. I want them to look authentic, so I have to figure that out.
Yeah,
nice, man.
Yeah, we'll see.
So, like, how long per day were you, like, sitting at that table at the Comic-Con?
Okay, so Thursday, well, so I took 3 days off my job, and so I took Wednesday to set up, then Thursday was preview night, so that started, it was open to the public, I think it opened to the public at 2 or 3, and it went till, I think it went till 9, and then the next day, and then it went from 10 to 6, no wait, 10 to 7 on Saturday, on Friday and Saturday, and then on Sunday it was from 10 to 5. So, yeah. it's a long weekend.
Sorry, I kind of zoned out. Like 8 hours then?
Yeah, about, yeah, yeah. Pretty much.
It is tough, though, being, you know, even like 8 hours is a normal work day. There's something about being at a con and just having to, like, talk to people like constantly and stuff. It's, like, really tiring. And on top of it, it's like you don't ever get a break, you know. There's, like, no lunch break unless you've got somebody there. Yeah. You know, you're just always, like, at that table. And then, you know, you come back the next day and do it all again, you know.
Yeah.
I imagine you can't, like, leave your stuff either because... No one's gonna watch.
It's probably not a good idea.
You can ask, like, yeah, your neighbor or something, but I always like am worried, you know. You take your cash box with you and stuff.
Yeah. Sometimes you're just sitting there, and you know, I guess you could be like drawing or whatever, but I tend to always kind of, I want to like not look like I'm bored or not do anything, and not look like I'm desperate. So I'm constantly trying to. Like do stuff, like I always look like I'm busy, because there's a perception if you look like you're desperate, like on some of those slow times, and you know, if somebody comes up to, for instance, if somebody comes up to my table and they're like, you know, first I want to make sure they're actually looking at my stuff and not just passing by, and if they show interest, then I'll say, hi, how's it going, or something like that, and then after that, I kind of turn my glance somewhere else, like I'm doing something else, because I don't want to like hover over people. So there's a lot of like weird
Are you ever, like, worried, like, because I know if I was, like, walking around and I seen some guy doing something, I'd be like, man, I don't want to bother him, he's busy.
Yeah.
No, because I don't know. I mean, there's always, you know, not everyone's the same, so there might be people that react like that. Sometimes what happens, though, there's times where somebody's looking at something and somebody will come by and then you engage them in conversation and then the other person maybe gets tired of waiting, they leave. So you have to keep kind of aware of that. Like if I'm talking to somebody and then somebody else shows up, just, you know, briefly I'll turn around and say, how's it going? And then, you know, and then kind of sometimes, like, pay attention to both people at the same time, sort of. So
yeah.
Sometimes it's hard to do that. So, it just depends. There's a whole, you know, there's just a lot of things you can try to do that's, you know, how different people behave and, you know, try to figure that out. And I don't know.
Yeah. It is weird. I mean, it's funny. It's like an experiment in, like, human nature, I noticed. Like,
yeah, exactly. That's kind of what I was getting at. Yeah.
Because you're just, like, just the different kind of people. I totally know what you mean, like, where, you know, you get that kind of shy, reserved person that's kind of, like, looking over things, and you'll get this sort of, like, other person who's, you know, asking questions, and you start talking to them. And then, like, a lot of times, you know, I think that, you know, the shyer type person wants to buy something or whatever, but they don't want to interrupt. They don't, you know.
Exactly.
They just kind of, like, go away, you know.
So there was a guy, I had just, my girlfriend had shown up, so I went and I was, like, checking out Artist Alley and everything. I got back, and I kind of asked how things were going while I was gone, and my girlfriend kind of whispered that, well, this guy's been here for a while, he's looking at stuff. So, and then, so I was there, and he was still just looking at everything, and very quiet, didn't say hardly anything at all. You know, and you get some people that get up there and they're just really enthusiastic, like, oh, this is great, this is great, this is great, and then they walk, then after that they walk off. So this guy very, I mean, hardly said two words, you know, but just kind of looking at everything, and he ended up just, then he starts picking things up.
Yeah.
And guy's going to buy some stuff. He bought like $75 worth of merchandise for me. He bought like two original sketches, the blueprint sketches. I was selling those for $20. He bought two of those. He bought, what else? I don't know. He bought all kinds of stuff. But, you know, like I said, he was even, like I said, I'm Scott, by the way. I could barely hear what his name said. He did sign up for the newsletter, so I did get his name. But it's just different people are different, you know. Some people are just very quiet, but they were, and he didn't, like I said, he wasn't enthusiastic about it, but I did hear him say, because I said, you know, thanks, I told him thanks for supporting independent artists in this and everything and all that, and he was like, oh, I could have spent more. So, I mean, he liked it, so it was just weird. You just, it's hard to tell with people.
You know? You let him get away?
Well, no, he like I said, he bought $75 worth of stuff, so.
Yeah. That's awesome, man. Surprises me, though, because I've had that same thing happen where you just, because you get the vibe, you know, some people that, you know, come up and talk to you, they buy stuff, and, you know, and once in a while somebody will walk away, but a lot of times when somebody starts talking to you, they end up buying something, and it always surprises me when somebody, like, is completely silent, and then they just get their money out, you know, it's just like, you almost, like, give up on them, and then you're like, what the...
Yeah, and so Mike, you know, he said that I let him go away. No, he signed up the newsletter, so he's still, you know, he'll.
So you just met like a fan, like this guy had no idea who you were before, and then he just was walking around.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And I think I probably doubled my newsletter subscribers. Not that it was very big to begin with, but I should have pushed a little harder. But the one thing I did was I had this little metal box, and I put all my magnets on it. And then I just put a sign on top of it saying, join the newsletter and get a free magnet. And a lot of people just asked about it and joined. I didn't even have to ask. That was kind of cool. So, and there were a couple, and usually if somebody did buy a lot of stuff or whatever seemed interest, I'd ask if they wanted to sign the newsletter, and they usually do. But there were a couple of people that, for whatever reason, I just kind of forgot to ask them. So... that happens a lot. There's times when you're like, oh, I should have did that, or I shouldn't have done that, or, you know. But it's right. you can't read everyone, but it is kind of reading people and, you know, and that type of thing, so.
And I, like, when I think about it, too, because you want to talk to the people that come up to the table, but then you know, just myself, you know, like when I'm shopping and stuff, like when I go to the art store, you know, that's like a place where they just jump on you immediately. Yeah. You know? And I'm always like, no, you know, it's like running the gauntlet just to get your, you know, pencils and stuff. And it's just like different people want different things. So it's hard to say like who you should like engage and try to sell stuff to and then who you can just like let shop, you know?
Yeah, I don't like going into like a furniture store or whatever because they're on commission and things like that. So I don't like that either. But I do want to let people know that I know that they're there and that, you know,
right.
they do need help, that I'm around. That's why I said I kind of acknowledge them and then I kind of move over and kind of do something else. So I'm not like hovering over them.
Yeah. And you know, not to make this whole show about cons again, I didn't mean to bring it back to this, but you know how you were saying about being in the booth section as opposed to the artist alley section? Because like the last con I went to, I didn't go to, you know, the last one or whatever, but the one before that, my table got moved to kind of like away from artist alley, and I was like in with the booths. I was like in with people selling, you know, like people had long boxes of comics and stuff. Mm-hmm. And there's some artists in there too, but we're really spread out. And I had different people, like at least two, I think, ask me, you know, if I was the artist, you know. And I just thought, that's so, who do you think I'm, you know what I mean?
Right.
They just thought I was like some shopkeeper or something just sitting there, which just seems super weird to me, you know.
Yeah.
And might be kind of like true, like what you were saying about, you know, people, I don't know, they want to buy from an artist, they go to Artist Alley maybe, I don't know, I'm not sure.
Yeah, I don't know, but it's, you know, it's just, and I know there were a lot of people that wanted to upgrade to booths that were in Artist Alley or whatever, but again, it's like a lot of them were selling fan art, and I mean, if you're, you know, and that's competitive too, because it used to be you could just be a mediocre artist and do fan art and do all right. But I mean, there's so much just excellent fan art out there right now that, I mean, you really kind of have to be good. If you're a good artist and you're doing fan art, you're going to do great, most likely. But when you're trying to, it's still an uphill climb for somebody like me who's trying to kind of build their own brand and stuff. So I don't know. Sometimes I think, well, maybe I should stay out there and just take a little bit of a hit. Just to, you know, just and chalk it up to advertising, you know, because the more shows you do, the more you're out there in front of people, and I mean, that's what people pay, you know, for, you know, part of their advertising budget is to be out in front of people. So I could look at it that like that too, but I don't know. I don't know how easy it's going to be to go back and forth, you know, if I go back to a table. If I decided I want to go back to the booths again, I don't know. But I mean, I'm just curious what difference it will make if I go back to Artist Alley, because the lower cost is one thing, and I'm just wondering if I might be able to do better there. I don't know. I could be totally wrong, but I don't know. I'm still trying to figure out what I'm gonna do.
You know, it's like a con is big, but it's not like, you know, the city of New York. I would think that everybody that wanders through, you know, the booths is going to wander down Artist Alley. So
I would think like so. And Artist Alley was so packed. I mean, this was on Sunday. I don't know what it was like the other days. That was the only time I could really get over there. But I mean, there were certain times where I could not like even hardly navigate because. Partially because the aisles are smaller in Artist Alley, whereas the booth, I mean, I had pretty good placement where my booth was because, like, there's, like, a fairly, it was almost like one of the main walkways. It's right by where all the banners were that say what the booth numbers are. Like, there's the aisles, like, aisle 100, 200, 300, 500, whatever. So, I mean, there was pretty decent traffic going there, so I don't know. It's all like you're just kind of testing things out. It seems constantly what works, what doesn't, and you know. And from year to year, sometimes things are different. It doesn't have. Sometimes it has something to do with what you're doing. Sometimes it doesn't. You know.
Well, that's true too. You know, there's an element of luck to everything too. You know, that you really can't control. I noticed in the chat, though, Creed actually said, I saw a video with two artists. I can't remember who, but they had a contest at a con. One sat facing straight forward at the customers, and one sat sideways. And the sideways guys always had sales and more sales.
I heard Will Terry talking about that in one of his videos, and that was something I kind of try to do, because like that's why I said when, but it's the way, so the way the booths are set up, I had a corner booth, so there's really no sideways. I mean, if I'm facing one way, then I'm facing forward on one direction. If I'm facing the other way, I'm facing, forward on the opposite. So you can't really do that at a booth where like you can with a table, but. What I did, like I said, when I'd say, hey, how's it going or whatever, and then I kind of turn, I kind of shift my shoulders over to something else. And so
to me, like, that just seems like, like the artist, like, identical, you know what I mean? Was one, like, a better artist, one more popular? You know, how could you, like, judge that as a thing that would actually tell you what sells better? That just sounds like.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that. Like, how does that make any difference? I mean, if the art's good.
Well, I mean, it does. It does and it doesn't. But like I said, there's so many different factors. Like I said, when I was saying, it could be something you're doing, or it could be the attendance. It could be a number of factors, and it's really hard to figure that out.
And then too, like sitting sideways, that almost seems weird. You like walk up to like a salesman. He's like standing sideways from you. Like, hey, dude. Hey, over here.
Right, but I understand. I get the idea of it, because if you're facing somebody, I mean, it's a little like, it's almost like this guy wants me to buy something. But if you're almost sort of like,
yes,
like you don't, like almost like you don't necessarily care. Not that you don't care, but that you're not putting as much pressure on it. I don't know.
It's like the soup Nazi theory.
Yeah, wear a shirt saying, I want you to buy something. That's why I brought all my crap here.
So, like, Creed says that, Scott, you should bring a pile of metal parts and look like you're busy building a death ray. That's pretty funny. You could, hire a bunch of, like, kids or something, like short people. That'd be pretty neat. Like, have them behind you just putting together some gigantic machine.
Well, that's the thing. I wonder, and I've talked, and this is one of the things I'm going to talk about when I do my video, but sometimes it's just easier to keep it simple. And I did try to simplify a lot of things, like with my signage and things like that, to make it a little more obvious, because the more complex you get, you have to realize there's just so much stuff going on at these conventions that it's hard to tell a story, It's like I've got one product and it sells all right, but I have to explain what it is, because it's a little, I call it the lab starter kit, and there's three different things. There's a growing brain that grows when you add water. There's a like glob that's just like a slime that glows in the dark, and then there's a space slug that'll crawl down walls. And it comes in like little tins, and it comes in a gift box, and it comes with the print. But that's a lot for somebody to get. No matter how clearly I spell it out or whatever, I have to explain what it is. And like, even that, like that one guy, he bought one of them, the one guy I was talking about before, the quiet guy, he bought one of them, and I think I'm pretty sure I mentioned that it came with the print, but he picked it up and didn't, and when I gave him the print, he was surprised, So it's like, and it's not because people are stupid or whatever, it's just, there's just too much there. I mean, because sometimes I'm like, okay, just read the sign. It says right there, like when people ask how much stuff it is. But if you put yourself in their shoes, and when you start going around shopping yourself, you'll be doing the same thing. Like I didn't see the sign that said what you just told me, because there's just too much. So really, it makes sense to simplify things as much as you can.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's totally, because you got to think, it's like a guy's walk. Just like when you go and check out Artist Alley, it's, you walk down like just aisles and aisles, and you get that sort of like all those desperate type artists that are like looking at you and wanting you to come over.
Right.
So you almost get that tunnel vision, where you don't want to read or look and stuff at certain things. You just want the stuff you want, So I agree. It's not that they're dumb. It's just, it's just overwhelming. Cons like super overwhelming.
Yeah. I mean, It's kind of interesting hearing you guys talk about this stuff because I've never actually been to a Comic-Con or anything like that.
Oh, really?
So, I mean, I don't even know what Artist Alley means or whatever the booth's at. I mean, I have an idea because of, like, movies and stuff, but, you know, I don't know if it's like that in real life or if it's different.
Yeah, especially if you ever consider like, exhibiting in a con, I would definitely suggest going to one just as a attendee first and just checking it out.
Denver Comic-Con next weekend, dude.
It's this week? When is it?
It's this weekend. It's like next weekend.
Is it? It's not this weekend?
No, I think it is this coming weekend. I think, or maybe it's next weekend. I don't know. One of those two.
It's usually the weekend after Phoenix, so it's probably this weekend, unless they change it. It might be
this one. I actually might go check that out then.
And I think I did see people post. Yeah, I definitely saw people posting about Denver coming up. So.
Yeah, I saw people some posting about you, which is weird. It's weird that I get other people's stuff about you
yeah,
and I don't
get stuff,
your stuff from Facebook. Yeah, but I saw a couple people snap pictures of you.
Oh, you know the other thing was I was in the local paper, and somebody said, "Oh, I saw you in the paper," and then they said, "Well, it wasn't actually the papers online." So I just assumed they were talking about because I saw a guy coming by. This is when I was setting up. I saw a guy coming by and taking pictures, and I just figured he was with the Phoenix Comic Con, and you know maybe I'd end up in the program or like on their website or something. But my mom called me and said, "You were in the paper today," and I'm like, "I am." And so I think I posted the picture online, but it's just all you can see is my legs, and I'm hanging up my sign and stuff. But yeah, somebody, you know, I got comments like, "Oh, that's great. That'll probably do great for sales or whatever." I'm like, I don't know. I don't know how many people actually read the paper, but they like repost it online, you know, because they've got the online version of the paper. So yeah. I don't know I had a couple people say they saw me, but I don't know that it really helped at all. It was kind of neat though.
Yeah, that's kind of cool.
Yeah, that's cool.
It must be because of your cool booth though. I mean, that paid off right there.
Well, yeah, I mean,
like it.
And that was early enough when I was setting up that, you know, I was probably the most interesting thing there because a lot of other places hadn't set up yet. But, yeah, I mean, that's the weird thing is, like, because sometimes I wonder if all that work in the booth is just for nothing because it's, like, you get a lot of people saying, oh, it's, like, one of the coolest booths I've seen and all that. But then a lot of people is just, it doesn't faze them because there's just so much stuff there, you know.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah.
Because really, you know, if some people can just walk into Artist Alley and just throw up, if they got cool looking prints, throw them up and, you know, just get just as big a response as what I do. So, I don't know.
I've seen people in Artist Alley, like, you know, creatively make, like, their table into almost a booth. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I've seen, like, some pretty cool setups over there, so. But. So if somebody's asking how much you charge for Urzel Art, I was just curious.
I'm sure that's you.
Which one he's talking about.
Yeah, I'm sure
he's talking about. Not really painting anything here, though, so.
Yeah, I don't know. What was it for original art? Yeah, I don't know. I have to ask who.
I think if you email any of us, you'll get an answer.
Okay. I haven't really been doing any commissions, so.
Didn't you say you kind of doodle and stuff, Jeff, when you're there and, like, people ask for sketches and, I mean, is that something that's, I mean, that seems like a good idea.
Well, I don't really do it anymore. When I used to go to cons, I did sit and draw. That was sort of, like, my thing. And,
that seems like a really good hook, like, to get people
in. It did work well. But it's also just, it's a lot of drawing and then you get people wanting sketches and commissions and stuff. And that can be really tough if you're selling stuff, you know, because you're looking down so much, it's hard to...
People could be robbing you blind or what?
Well, no, but I guess that could happen, but it's just, you know, you don't want somebody to come up and want something and then leave because it's like you're not ignoring them, you know?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's why I stopped doing sketches and stuff at cons because I want to be present enough, like... You know, is if some people are just buried in their phones, some people are buried in their artwork, and I mean, there's a lot of people that you can make it work, but you just have to. The best way to do that if you're going to do sketching is to have somebody there with you, that can like interact with the crowd and stuff. Because you don't, if you're just there by yourself and you got your nose down and drawing, then you're probably missing out on some sales.
Yeah,
because like my wife is really awesome. Whenever she comes to watch the table, I always seem to sell more. She just got that, you know, awesome personality that people buy stuff from. And like if you could go there with her and she'd be there and just sell stuff, yeah, you probably could clean up. You know, like Adam Hughes, I know, you know, he'll just sit there and draw. And like Travis Stray, they'll, you know, make all kinds of money off of commissions. But I don't know. You got to be ready for it, you know.
Yeah, those guys, though, I mean, they you know, they don't have to do art. I mean, their stuff is so, they're so famous and their stuff's so good that they don't hardly have to do anything and they're selling stuff, so.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Go ahead.
I was going to say, what are you sketching there, Jeff? It looks like a shark. It looks really cool.
Yeah. Well, this guy looked like he was swimming, so I thought I'd throw a shark. I guess I'm thinking about that movie that's coming out, the shark that attacks the chick or whatever.
I saw the trailer for that. That movie looks either really bad or it could be really good. It's like one of those, like, I'm not sure. It could be good. I don't know.
Who knows? So, I don't know. You ever thought about doing, like, you know, like a Justin Roche type? I mean, just to change gears to animation, because, I don't know, we got to name the show something, right?
Yeah.
But you ever think about just changing gears, like, Mike, or trying to just, you know, do, like, a short film or something, like that guy Justin Roche or something, and maybe try to kickstart it at some point or something?
Yeah, I mean, I'm actually taking a little bit of inspiration from you on that, and I have some stuff in the works. You know, as far as stop motion, I mean, I always do, but this is actually something I'm going to share and, you know, try and get, you know, some people behind and get some kind of fan going and some fan base on animation. Because, I mean, that is truly, like, the thing I love the most.
Yeah.
And sculpting for me was always a way to like, fund the animation, which, I mean, that doesn't always necessarily happen, but, I mean, the potential for it is there.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm definitely changing gears, like my whole life really, in the next coming couple months. So, I'm definitely gonna have a lot more time for animation here soon.
Are you still working? I mean, I don't know if you want to talk about that stuff on air, but are you still working that crazy job with all those hours and stuff?
Yeah, I am.
Yeah.
But not for too much longer.
Hmm. Kind of cryptic. You gotta pull like Jeff Lafferty and just not show up for work for a week or two. And
no, I'm gonna have some class about it, but
unlike Jeff Lafferty.
No, I actually already put my my notice in.
Yeah, and
it's not like I have a lot of money. It's actually a really stupid. I mean, if I think about it too long, I always talk myself out of it. But I just woke up one day and said, you know, I'm going to gun for it.
Hmm.
So
well, that's pretty awesome, dude. And that's pretty like ballsy. But you know.
Yeah, it is. It really is because it's a really good job.
Yeah.
And a lot of people would kill to have it, but you know, I'm kind of over the whole, you know, 14-hour days, and like always putting art and everything else like second to this, you know, to this thing. So
yeah,
and I don't want to get to a point where, you know, I look back and I'm like, God, I really wish I would have given art a shot.
Right.
So yeah,
well, that was a lot of like my motivation for sure. I just felt like my days were getting stolen from me, and you know, it just felt like, you know, after, you know, I'm like an old guy, so I've been like trying the whole, you know, do the full-time job and do it on the side forever, and it just freaking doesn't work, you know. At some point you just got to go like, you know what, that doesn't work. I'm not going to do it that way anymore. I'm not telling you, you know, do it or not do it, but that's the way I started looking at it.
No, yeah, and I think that's a very, you know, I've actually, you know, there's a guy I met, you know, actually the first sculptor I've ever met in Colorado, or ever in person, really. And I met this guy in Springs a few months ago, just by total chance. And he's been sculpting for 50 years. And he's like made millions of dollars, and he's got all kinds of, like, he owns his own building, and I mean, this guy's just pumping it out like crazy, and it's all contained, you know, in Colorado Springs. Wow. And so I went up and showed him some of my stuff, and we hit it off. And he took me up to his like studio area, which is above the gallery floor, and you know, we just became fast friends. This guy's way older than me, and he's just a really cool dude. And he kind of had some really cool tips and life advice, I guess, which, I mean, I kind of knew, but, I mean, just to hear him say it, and, you know, it takes kind of a different perspective.
Right.
That's cool. What kind of stuff does he sculpt?
It's, like, all original, like, little figures, like a painter or, like, a guy, you know.
Okay.
Construction worker, like, a bust of a construction worker, a school teacher. And he's actually, you might have actually heard of this guy, Jeff, but he has a, he's got like inside of his gallery, he's got a thing called Magic Town, and it's a town that he built, and he's got, like you walk in and it's like you pay like $3 or $4 to get in or whatever, and it's like sets and everything, like kind of like built up like stop motion, but it's not stop motion, and he's got like, you know, like you'll look in a window and the lights will change and it'll come on and it'll be a different scene. And then the lights will go off and then it'll be a different scene inside of that. And he uses like a lot of trick photography and like, you know, glass angled and lights, you know, all kinds of stuff. And it was really cool. And he's like, yeah, it actually is pretty cool. And he's, you know, he's like a really, just a really cool dude. Sorry, I'm trying to, like, figure out stuff and talk.
Right, no, I totally get that. Well, that's wild, man.
But, no, I've just, like, recently I've really, really been, like, spending time trying to figure out a way to make money and, you know, and I have been, so.
Yeah.
Like serious money, like money I could just focus on stuff with.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the net is definitely a good way to do it, for sure. There's money to be made on the internet, for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, there is. But one of the things I did learn from this guy, which was interesting, was none of it he does online.
Really?
Which I found, you know, kind of shocking. He is now, but, like, for 50 years he didn't.
Yeah.
And, I mean, that was what kind of grabbed me. I was like, wow, that's actually really interesting.
Yeah, that's true.
And just like walking into another sculptor's studio was like fantastic, because I mean, I've never seen one, so.
Right. Yeah, that's cool, man. What's does he sell like at galleries and stuff? I mean, what's his kind of like? Where does he sell his stuff?
It's just his own gallery.
Okay, so he's got his own shop.
Yeah, he owns the whole building. He owns this whole big building and. Like downstairs, he's got like an elevator that goes to all these floors, and downstairs is where he molds and casts everything. He's got like 15 people down there, and then upstairs is the gallery, like the ground floor, and then on the very top, he's got like studios that he rents out to other like businesses and artists and stuff, and then he's got his apartment, which is connected to like his studio and everything.
Yeah.
And that's where he, like, sculpts. And then when he's done, he sends it downstairs. They mold it. And then it goes to the middle to sell.
Boy.
Wow.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, it is. And, I'll have more on all this later. I don't want to, like, go too crazy with ambition and then, fall flat. But.
Totally. No, it's cool, though. I think it's neat. I mean, you know. It's also scary as hell, I know. It's more scary, I think, before you do it than when you actually do it.
Yeah, and actually, one of the things that helped, you know, me decide on this was, in one of your guys' videos, you, Kevin, and Scott were all chatting, and you said, you know, you don't know the kind of, you know exactly how much money you're going to make at your job. You can, like, forecast it. You know exactly what the amount is going to be.
Mm.
But, like, what you don't know is how much you'll make if you just break free, and, like, you don't know that what that money's going to look like. It could be more, it could be less. And, you know, I don't think it's going to be more anytime soon, but there's definitely the potential there for you know, if you know, I feel if, it's cool seeing someone else do it that's like no one knows about. And you know, especially with sculpting and stuff like that. And it's like not, it's not copyrighted characters. It's not like Spider-Man. It's none of that stuff. It's all.
Yeah.
And he actually invited me to an art show just a couple weekends ago. And I was like Snapchatting the whole thing, but they had like, he only had like maybe 25 people that he invited, and like, I don't know, he must have made like 40 or 50 grand that night.
Wow.
And, like, I didn't know who I was rubbing elbows with there, but like, this guy sold stuff to John Elway and like the President of the United States and like several of them.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I mean, this guy's work is everywhere, but like, I guess you wouldn't really know it.
And you said he kind of took a liking to you?
Yeah, we became fast friends.
That's cool. Like that says a lot about your work, Mike, because or your personality or both or whatever, because, I mean, obviously he's got other sculptors and stuff, sounds like, working for him, or he has, and for him to see something in you like that, that, you know, that's cool.
No, that's actually, he doesn't have any sculptors. He had his son helping him for a little while, but then he even fired him, so.
Oh, okay.
It was actually, he like sculpted everything in that whole place, which was crazy. And then like Magic Town is like, you know, all these characters and stuff that he sells that you can go out and buy, like once you see him in there, but you can go out and buy them. And then like he repurposes them and puts them in different scenes and like stuff, you know, inside the place.
Yeah.
It's really cool. Like definitely if you guys are ever in the Springs, check out Magic Town for sure.
Mm.
Yeah. Yeah, it's funny. I haven't ever really heard of it.
I had never heard of it either, man. It was crazy. And I've like, I know all kinds of sculptors. I've been studying it for years. And
yeah.
I never even knew the guy existed.
Yeah. It's wild.
But he's got a really cool story. Like he started out really young, and like he was basically just like a drunk. And he hitchhiked into South America, and he didn't have any money, so he figured out he could sculpt. He got into this school and figured out he could sculpt a little bit, and he would make originals and go door to door and sell those for like $4 or $5 each, just to like survive. And he did that for like 4 or 5 years, and then he finally came back, and then he met this guy who was like, stealing other people's work by making molds and then selling those. And he learned how to make molds from that guy, and then that's when he learned how to like start making a business. And then he would just go like door to door, and I mean, it just kind of kept growing and growing.
That's wow.
And he's like a huge part of like Manitou.
Yeah. Oh yeah, because that's like a little arty type town right there, or part of Colorado Springs or whatever. All kinds of galleries and stuff up there. That's cool, man. What's this thing about like chat, Snapchat? I noticed like when you guys jumped on, and you just mentioned it again. You guys were all talking about stuff that's going on in Snapchat. That's like completely out of my world. I want to know what's going on here.
It's fantastic, Jeff.
Yeah. I mean, I'm brand new to it. I just started snapping like. Last week, or maybe the beginning of this week, or over the weekend, or something. But it's all mobile, so unfortunately, that's the only way you can do it is if you have a smartphone. But I like it because it's almost like a mini blog or whatever. It like only how long do they what how long is each snap, Mike?
10 seconds.
10 seconds. So it's, you know, it's like you're posting little small videos, and there's definitely a lot more to it, and a lot of people just get on there and do goofy stuff or whatever. I use it just to share my work, or like what I'm going to do with mine, or what I have been doing is more, because I kind of got away from like what I was doing with the 100 days where I was actually doing some vlogging or like talking about, you know, kind of my daily routine and things like that. So this is what I'm doing on Snapchat is going to be more like behind the scenes, or more like behind that fourth wall, you know, because now everything I put on YouTube is kind of, you know, here's me in the art lab and all this kind of stuff, and it's not really as personal. So I'm like showing some process stuff. I'm showing, like, I showed what happened, like, with my, that I showed the behind the scenes of that set that I shoot from my YouTube videos and stuff like that. So it's kind of like the behind the scenes stuff. That's what I'm using it for.
Yeah, I kind of just like it because you kind of control, like, you're, well, not really control, but, like, you, the audience that you have on there is, like, people that you could, you have on your phone, or if they find your Snapcode or whatever. It's a much more intimate, like, showing of, like, getting feedback on work, or, I mean, it's not like anyone can just search sculpting or something and find you. They have know you. Yeah, they have to know you, or they have to find your Snapcode. They basically have to look for you and find you, and then they have to choose to follow you to see the work. It's not like, you know, it just randomly shows up in a search engine somewhere.
Yeah, and if you're trying to, I mean, if you're using it to try to build an audience, that's not the way to do it. You've got to kind of bring your audience to you. So that's why, so what I did was you'll do these little, you know, 10-second clips, all right, these snaps, and then you can put them to what they call a story, and then the story just compiles all of them. And then if you want, you can save them to your phone or whatever. That's what I've been doing. And then now I'm compiling them and I'm putting them on YouTube because it goes away after 24 hours or whatever. So if you don't see it, then it's gone unless you save it. So what I'm doing now is I'm putting them all together and putting them as a YouTube video so people can see what I'm doing on Snapchat, and then hopefully they'll go and find me on Snapchat and follow me. So right now I don't have a lot of people following me. But I don't know. It seems like it's the next kind of big thing, so I kind of want to jump on it now while it's just right now starting to go big. But I stayed away from a while just because of that whole idea that that's going to be gone. People aren't going to see it, and it's hard to get used to because it doesn't seem very.
It's not user friendly very much at all.
It's not user friendly. I had, you know, my 11-year-old daughter is teaching me how to use it. So, you know, it's easy for her. All her friends use it and stuff. But I don't know. I actually like it. I like the stuff that I'm putting on there and stuff. And it's not too difficult. There's a lot of weird things. Like, it's for the way you film, you have to hold the button down, like, on your phone, so you can't. It's hard to, like, if you wanted to do a drawing video, because you have to hold it with your hand. If you take your hand off of it, it won't record. So it's almost like anything you have to do if you're doing something like that has to be one-handed. So
I really hope they'll come out with something like you can film it by any other means, and then just, you know, take 10 seconds or whatever and put it on there.
Yeah, I'm sure there'll be third-party stuff that you can do stuff like that. So
yeah, because that holding the button thing is. Like, I can't do it ever, so.
yeah, because you need two hands to, like, sculpt, so. Anyway, yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah, that's wild. I don't know if I'll check it out, though, because it sounds.
Yeah, I mean, I'm guessing, I know Kevin said he was on it and he hated it, so, I mean, it's probably not for everyone, but.
Now I'm almost interested in, like, what you guys are doing there. is there, like, a place you have to have a phone to go watch, or is it? Can you at least log in on a computer?
Well, if you go to my YouTube channel, Jeff, you can see the first one. I compiled everything and I posted on it. So there's a video on there that I just call them Cirque Snaps, and I got more that I'm going to put up there. So you can kind of get an idea of what I'm posting from that.
Yeah, that's cool.
And the other thing, too, is, like, it gives you points for everything you post, or if any time someone takes a screenshot of it or anything like that.
Yeah, I haven't figured out that part of it yet. There's, like, trophies and weird. There's, like, there's a lot of, like, weird, like, stuff to it. Like, you get these trophies. Like, one of them is if you take a picture and it's 100 degrees outside, at least, and I'm like, well, I got that covered because it's summer in Arizona. But there's just, like, weird stuff like that. I don't know.
Yeah, and there's, like, a lot of funny face filters and,
you know. Yeah. A lot of people are just doing it being goofy, but I'm using it for more, I don't know, behind the scenes stuff, so.
Yeah, it's a good way to get feedback by people that actually, you know, that are on there and they actually want to, like, comment or you know, they're like, they have to go basically out of their way to look at your stuff. It's not just shows up in a feed or a scroll somewhere.
Yeah.
Which means they're, you know, almost means they kind of really want to look at it or whatever.
Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, I mean, it's like the frustrating thing about, like, Facebook, you know, you just don't know. You know what I mean? It's like people friend you, and then you, like, never hear from them again.
Yeah, they're just trying to pad a friend list or something.
Something.
So, Ox says, you can snapshot a stop-motion clip for people, and he says, making a short story of stop-motion snaps would be cool for sure.
Yeah. I'd have to go just look. I'm going to go watch your video that you told me, Scott, so I can just kind of get an idea, because it's almost like I can't wrap my head around it at this point.
Yeah. It took a long time. 10-second
videos. That makes some stop motion. I'm sorry. Mike, go ahead.
I was just going to say, it takes a while to get used to the whole format. I mean, it's not like... It definitely is not very user friendly. Like I'm still figuring stuff out on it now. I mean, I've only had it for a few months or whatever, but I'm not sure. I mean, it's kind of a cool tool. I mean, it can be fun. It's cool to just post a quick little clip and it instantly goes to a little feed and then it makes it a story, and then you can download the whole story, like everything you post, and then you can post that somewhere else, which I think is a cool feature.
See, yeah. I haven't even figured how to download the whole story, because I'm saving each individual clips to my phone. So there's a way to download the whole story?
Yeah, you just go over to the right, and it'll have like an arrow with like a pointing down, and you just click that when it says your My Story.
Uh-huh.
You click that, and it downloads everything that's in your story in a little video clip form, even if it's a mixture of clips and pictures.
Okay, well, that'll make it easier for me, because I've been taking each individual snap and putting them together, so.
Yeah, that's a lot of work.
Yeah. I'm old. I can't figure this stuff out.
Well, shoot, I don't know. Did we talk it to death today? It's about 11:30. I think we've been going for an hour.
I don't know. We usually go like an hour and a half, don't we? But we can, whatever.
We can. Do you guys want to talk about, you guys got some other stuff, or didn't mean to like cut everybody short for sure?
No, I mean, I don't have anything in particular to talk about, but.
Is there any questions? Anybody ask any questions?
Yeah, you could probably go back to the chat.
Let's see, Art, Creed's got something new in here. Oh, yeah, see, so Creed says, too many things now are phone only. That sucks for people who don't have or want a phone like me.
Yeah.
I agree with you, Creed.
I know Jeff's going to agree with that.
I just got, like, a new phone, and it took me forever to find, like, another flip phone, so.
Did you just say flip phone?
Yeah. Where's it at? It's not in here, but, yeah, it was like I had to, like, hunt to find another phone like my other phone. They're all like the smartphones now.
Jeez, man. My dad is like, I just got my dad a phone, and he's like figured out Facebook and everything, and he's like sending me pictures all the time, and my mom's all into it. You gotta switch over, man.
Yeah, Jeff's got one of those burner phones.
Yeah. Cost me $20.
I guess if all you want to do is make phone calls.
Well, what else do you do with a phone?
You follow great artists on Snapchat. That's one of the things now.
Tim Phillips says he rocks the smart or the flip phone too.
Oh man.
I will say I do miss the ones with the actual like I had one that had like the QWERTY keyboard with actual buttons. It's so much easier to type when you can push down buttons, but yeah,
right.
You don't find those that much anymore. So
I know that's how my camera is. It's got like the screen on the back instead of like a button. It's just so hard to see if it's going. You know, see, I push the button on the screen instead of like a normal button. I don't know. All these newfangled things.
It's good. Little cattywampus real quick.
It's like my dad, like he when he got his phone, he actually has like a, I mean, I don't know, I think he's got an iPhone or something, but he told the guys at this place, he said, you need to disable this text because I'm never going to use it, and I don't want to get text, and I don't want everyone to see it. So somehow they turned the texting feature off of it.
Wow.
That's awesome. Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know. My mom, she's like texting and stuff. And she does have, I think she does have a flip phone. And those suck. I wouldn't want to text on one of those because you got to press, those are the ones where you have to press the numbers like 3 times. You know?
Right. Right. Go through the letters.
Forget about that.
If you need a pee. Yeah, that's
I just learned how to use a computer. Now I gotta like use a computer on my phone. It's just like, ah, man. Too much.
Come on, if you can figure out Google Hangouts, I mean, you could definitely figure out.
Right. But Google Hangouts was actually kind of hard to figure out. That's true.
I remember that took a long time.
Yeah, you were there with me in the beginning when we were like getting the thing like live. I remember doing like the experiments with you.
Yeah, that you was know. Man, that was a long time ago.
We're trying to get it to go through Skype and record it.
Oh yeah, like, oh yeah, that's right.
Remember that?
Yeah, like you tried recording one night, it filled up your hard drive. Right. Yeah.
You were like trying to do, wait. You were trying to do Google Hangouts through Skype?
Well, we were trying to just do live shows that we could record, and I thought I'd upload them, and so I had downloaded this like free software somewhere. And like we fired it up, we went for about 15 minutes, and then like my computer starts flashing at me that I don't have enough space on my hard drive. I look at this video, and it's like, I don't remember.
Like 45 gigs long or something.
Right. No, it was more, but yeah. It was like filling my hard drive. I was like, how, what? And then we ended up trying Google Hangouts at some point.
And then we turned the quality down so bad where it was like...
Right.
Like 8 second pictured lag.
Yeah. I think we recorded a couple shows like that, but I don't know if we ever uploaded them.
Yeah, I don't know whatever happened to those.
I know it's like it's come a long way because at first, like, I wanted to use Google Hangouts for a long time, but at the time they didn't have like a chat, and I had done some live streaming. This was even before I was on YouTube, but I had done some live streaming, like when I was at the game company. And they always had, like, people in the chats. So I wanted to do the same thing. But at that time, like, you couldn't do a chat on Hangouts. But now that you can, it's, like, pretty awesome. The other thing I want to start doing is I've seen a bunch of people doing the Facebook live streaming. I want to try that out.
Yeah.
Have you tried that, Mike? Or are you on Facebook? Or?
Yeah, I'm on Facebook. I've never done that. I think you have to be a business or something. Your page has to be a business or something.
Oh, maybe. I don't know if you still do. I thought I heard that too, but yeah, maybe it is. I'm not sure. You might have to have a Facebook page. I'm not sure.
I wonder if you do, because they sent me like a message, you know, because you guys were talking about it the other day, and then I just got a random message from like Facebook saying that I could stream if I wanted to.
Yeah.
And I was kind of wondering, like, what, you know, I have to ask? I mean, so maybe it's because I have the page or something. I don't know. Weird. I don't know why. I'm just so, like, down on Facebook anymore.
That yeah, I always
mess with whatever they've got going anymore, you know?
Yeah. I was of that opinion, too, but there are certain things that they seem like they're rolling out now that seem like, and again, it's just because of Kickstarter and the success I had through Facebook with that, because that seemed to be the only one thing that works. So they're kind of coming back around, but there's still a lot of stuff I don't like about Facebook. So
yeah, if it wasn't
go ahead, Mike.
I was just gonna say, if it wasn't for Facebook, I mean, I would have never contributed.
Yeah, so there you go, right there.
Yeah, so, I mean, I don't think I've ever even been to your website, so.
Yeah.
I mean, definitely I would have missed the ball on that one.
Yeah. And somehow you luck, somehow, you know, I don't know how you managed to see it, because you, I mean, that's part of the biggest problem is not everyone's seen on my post. So that's why, you know, I would have, if I would have had the time, I would have started, contacting people through Messenger and letting them know about it, but I didn't, so.
Maybe that's, like you were saying, cause didn't you say you bought a couple of Facebook, you know, promote a post or something? Maybe that's
yeah, I did. Maybe that could have helped. Some of those weren't to, some of them were, like the second one I did, that wasn't to, like, just my fans. That was the one where I targeted it, where I said, people who like Goonies and who like zombies and who like Kickstarter and who like comics. And so, I mean, I'm guessing just because of that, that was so narrow that it wasn't a lot of people that already followed me. So that would that one probably just went out to, you know, people who like all that stuff. But I think I did one before, but, like, because Mike, well, maybe I'm wrong. I'm trying to, I don't remember if you backed later on in the campaign or when, so I don't know exactly when you would have seen or, you know, heard about it.
Were you asking me?
Yeah.
I don't,
You probably don't remember, like, where the campaign was anyway, so.
Yeah, I just looked at the video real quick and then threw money at it. I mean, I didn't really.
But it was the video that you saw, right?
I think I just seen, like, maybe a post Jeff did or
okay.
Off Facebook. I don't even know if it was you necessarily, because I know we're pals on there, but.
Yeah, but you probably don't see, because, like I said, I haven't seen any of your stuff either, so it's just, that's the thing I don't like about Facebook is that.
Well, I don't ever post anything, so.
Okay, well, that could be too.
Probably that's the leading what I was going to ask. You were posting stuff, because I was like, I haven't seen nothing either, but. Every now and then I'll see you post something, and it seems like it comes through, though. But.
Did you post anything in the Artcasters page or whatever?
For the chat?
No, for the either one of your Kickstarters. I mean, is it really a problem where people are seeing posts on Facebook? I didn't even know that was a thing.
Yeah, it is kind of a problem. Not everyone sees it. Like, even stuff.
What'd you say?
I was going to say, I see stuff from all kinds of, like, you know, people that you have as friends on there that you don't really even care about or want to see.
I know.
Yeah, I can't figure it out. But yeah, Jeff did share a lot. I had tons of people sharing my stuff. But then again, before I was saying, I didn't know. I knew it helped some. I wasn't sure how much, but that's probably how you saw it, Mike. So, I mean, I know it does help, but it didn't do what I thought it was going to do. Like every time I was on the Artcasters or whatever, we'd talk about it. And then the next day, you know, it didn't seem like the backer, like, I thought the backer level would go up, like, after that, because people, you know, people would be hearing about it. But, yeah, it's just weird.
Huh. That's interesting. I didn't even, I guess, know that was a problem.
Well, I don't know if it's a problem, but, I mean, you know, Facebook's been doing that for a while, where they limit your posts. It doesn't go out to all your friends. They, like, you know, supposedly you're trying to, like, just make you see what you're into. So, like, if you're clicking on a lot of, you know, likes on certain things, they, like, put more of that in your feed or something, in theory. But I think what it really does is they're just trying to get you to pay money to get your posts out to people, you know?
Yeah.
Well, that's kind of my complaint with Facebook. But, I mean, even beyond that, you know, like, the thing with Facebook, like, I even noticed that with, like, the stop motion stuff, you know. It's like, when I was doing it before, you know, Facebook wasn't that much of a thing. I don't even know if I was on it, you know. And I've just noticed, like, you know, the fans or whatever, like, that whole community is kind of, like, left the places that they were hanging out before, like, the forums and stuff, and they've kind of moved to Facebook. And it's, like, super hard to, like, follow it anymore, you know what I mean? It's, like, really hard to, and you join the groups, and there doesn't seem to be, like, the community that was there before, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm just complaining, but.
That is true, because it seems like before, like, people started going to, like, those fan, I guess if you actually go to the fan page, you can see anything that's going on, but most people don't. Most people just wait to see what pops up in their feed, and you rarely see much of it.
Yeah.
But whereas if you're like a some kind of a, you know, forum or something, you'd probably see it more. You'd see it better. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. I used to hit like art forums like all the time, and it seemed like I don't know, could keep up with my friends' stuff better than Facebook, yeah. Which is weird.
I actually used to go to this forum all the time also, and I mean, I haven't been to a forum in a long time.
Yeah.
It definitely does seem like everything has slowly shifted to Facebook. I mean, Facebook, Twitter, or...
Yeah. YouTube.
Yeah, or YouTube. Which, I mean, YouTube, I think, is the best out of all of those.
Yep, I agree. Yeah,
I'd agree.
I mean, there's certain things you can't do on YouTube, but...
Yeah, like porn. What are you talking about? I can't do.
Well, I'm just the way it works as a social network. Like, well, I guess you can, I think you can send, like if I just wanted to say, if I wanted to put a post up that said, hey, sorry I didn't get a video up late today, I'm working on something or whatever. You can't really do stuff like that, you know, like alerts and things and let people know, unless you just put up a real short video, but it's not worth doing that. But, you know, stuff like that, I mean, it's... Certain things you could do easier on other social networks that it's just Facebook's not designed for that type of thing. I mean, YouTube's not designed for that type of thing.
Yeah, that's true. If you want to talk to people on YouTube, it's kind of got to be a production. So.
Yeah.
And then actually somebody else mentioned this in the chat. I noticed Tim Phillips said a lot of people are using Twitch now. And somebody else said, like, I think way in the beginning of the chat, we should be on Twitch.
Is Twitch still more, like, game-oriented? Because... There's a number of things like that. There's Twitch, and, you know, I think if I was going to do anything like a live streaming thing, I'd probably use Periscope, but
I don't even know what that is. I know what Twitch is, but I don't know what Periscope is.
It's like a live streaming. I think it might only be through the phone, but you can record, like if you wanted to record your drawing, and it will broadcast it through the app or whatever. And you can record it and put it on YouTube or whatever. I think it's the same principle as like Twitch, or there's some other ones too like that.
Huh. Yeah. Have you tried that one yet?
Periscope?
Yeah.
No, I signed up for an account. I just haven't got around to it. I wanted to, like, scope the, you know, setting up at the con, but then when I started using Snapchat, I was like, oh, I can do this with Snapchat. But, of course, Snapchat's these small little intervals that string together, whereas Periscope, you can just do one long thing. And also it has a chat feature. So, you know, you could be drawing, and you're drawing live. You know, it's not like Snapchat where you film it. If you're happy with it, then you post it. Periscope, you're streaming live, so kind of like what we're doing now, and people can comment or whatever, but it's all through, you know, the app.
Yeah.
With Twitch, though, and Tim Phillips said a lot of artists use it, and I have noticed that a lot of artists seem to use it, but I don't go over to Twitch and look for them. It seems like what I end up watching is like when they put their Twitch stream or an edited version of their Twitch stream on YouTube.
What's the other one that a lot of artists were using or still are? I keep getting alerts when people are on there. I forgot. What
Picardo?
Was that? Yeah, Picardo. Yeah.
That's the one like you and I were looking at, Jeff, right?
Porn,
like,
yeah.
They're like drawing all those like flirt furry animals.
Right.
It just seemed like they were, I don't know what was going on over there, but it seemed like they were doing a lot of that, and it was popular, so I mean.
Well, yeah, that's definitely popular there.
Because like when Snapchat was first came out, kind of it was a lot of people, you know, sending naked pictures back and forth. But I think, I'm sure, I know people are still doing that, but I think it's kind of gone away from that now, at least as far as, you know. But that's what drives probably almost most products.
The internet.
Yeah.
I know, it's always like the first thing that happens to whatever comes along. For the early adopters.
Yeah, I heard that's why like Blu-ray won over HD videos is because the porn industry said it was going to go with Blu-ray. And that pretty much decided the whole thing.
Is Blu-ray 1 now? That sucks. I'm behind on another thing.
Wait, Jeff, are you really that far behind? I mean, HD video hasn't been around for like years. You know what we're talking about? Remember the HD video? There was HD, and then there was Blu-ray.
Well, yeah, but I mean, you could still get like normal DVDs, like
we're not talking DVD versus Blu-ray. We're talking at one point when the HD videos came out, meaning HD meaning HD brand or whatever, and Blu-ray. There were two different formats. There was HD, and there was Blu-ray, and then Blu-ray kind of won out. But we're not talking DVD versus Blu-ray, because you can still buy DVDs and stuff.
But it will probably end up.
I don't know. It seems like DVDs will still be around along with Blu-ray until something else comes by even better, and then neither one. You know, I don't know. It doesn't. It seems like I still see as many DVDs as I do Blu-ray almost.
Yeah,
especially at a pawn shop.
I don't know, yeah, and I don't know why, because, I mean, Blu-ray is almost, the price points are almost similar now, so I don't know. But I don't really, you know, I usually just rent stuff from my Netflix thing, so I don't know. I don't buy a lot of either one. I think the last Blu-ray I bought was Star Wars.
And then, let's see, Quinlan Gretzky, is that like Gaz's wife?
Yeah, that's Gaz's wife. Yeah, that's cool.
Twitch would probably be really good for someone who does drawings on a tablet or PC, because you can stream your scene as opposed to jacking up your cell phone in a weird holder. Yeah, probably.
Yeah.
There's a lot of artists on Twitch, though. And I also noticed like there's a lot of like prop type makers and costume makers, and all those guys seem to have the Twitch account.
Well, that's funny that Q said that, because I think Gaz uses Periscope, or at least he was. I don't know.
Maybe that's why she said it, because he's doing it wrong.
Oh, okay.
I'm just reading the chat now. It's rocking again. The DVD thing, man, touched a nerve with some people. Since I use DVDs still, I've got like 500 DVDs. I remember when I had like 500, you know, plus cassette.
Don't even say VHS. Good goodness.
Well, the good thing is, I mean, I think the reason, the reason why you can still get DVDs and stuff, because Blu-ray players will play regular DVDs, where I don't think when they had the HD players and the Blu-ray player, I don't think they were compatible, so.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know, like, Xbox 360 or whatever, they went with HD DVDs, and then PlayStation went with Blu-ray, and everyone was like, oh, man, what's going to happen? Which one are they going to pick?
Yeah.
That was like the...
Gaz says twice, and then Gaz...
Oh, is that it?
She says, Gaz used Periscope like twice, and then she says, I'm Gaz's technical manager.
Okay.
And then Gaz says, I don't enjoy live stream at all, unless he's on our show. He loved it on our show.
I didn't know Gaz was married. That's cool.
Well, he might not be. Maybe they just live together in sin or something.
Well, yeah, so... HG Brown says that she uses Twitch, so I don't know. Maybe I'll give Twitch a shot. I don't know. There's so many things.
See, Periscope is more like crafters. That's what HG Brown says. Okay. She said crafters like a dirty word. She's like, ah, it's just for crafters. Then somebody says, I just picked up a VHS player so my son can watch the classic Disney flicks. There you go, still buying VHS.
I've got a bunch of those in my cabinet. That a lot of some stuff they haven't even, like all the Disney movies and stuff that I never, you know, got on VHS or on DVD. And I don't have a player, so they're just kind of sitting there.
So what? Quinlan says, your face lives together in sin. I don't understand that. Well, this is cool. The chat's going for a change instead of just sitting there quiet.
It's like, yeah, it's weird. Cause like, was it last week? It started off and then it just died out.
Yeah. People are passionate about VHS. I remember when I was painting, there was like this one kid that was working with me. And he was like looking for VHS copies of all these movies on eBay all the time. I'm like, VHS? What are you looking for VHS for? He's all into it. So let's see. It's pronounced Quellen, not Quinlan. She's correcting my pronunciation of her name. Quellen? I don't know.
It's just going to get it worse.
That's what you just say.
Just say Q.
I always thought that was Q.
It was like a James Bond reference or something. But I guess she's an actual Q. It's pretty wild. Well, you got to marry her then.
Yeah, that's a no-brainer.
That's right. Well, she says correct, so whatever I said was good.
What was it?
I gotta push my luck. So AC Brown says she's always looking for laser discs because they're like hard to find nowadays.
Well, yeah, because there are certain things that only came out on laser disc, and that's like the best quality you can get.
Is it really?
Yeah.
I mean, those ones that were like the size of a record, and you had to like they weighed 15 pounds, and wow.
Yeah, I remember at one point I was looking, and this was back when they were like super expensive, and I was going, oh man, I want to get a laser disc player and everything, and I'm glad I didn't, because they didn't last very long after that.
No. They were kind of dead right when they started, it seemed like.
But I think like for something like Star Wars, I think the only way you can get like the original ones in that high quality is on Laserdisc.
Really?
You know, before they did the special editions, I think. Or maybe not. I think maybe recently they released them without special edition. I don't remember. But for a while that was the case.
Yeah. Creed says, not everything on VHS is out on DVD, especially all the horror. H.C. Brown says they're like the size of a pizza. H.C. Brown, man, she could be a comedian.
Well, you can tell she's younger because most people would say the size of a record. But
anime on Laserdisc was the poop or pop. I'm not sure what you meant. Timothy Phillips said that. He said Scott is correct on something. Something you said was good, Scott. Oh,
attaboy, Scott.
A broken clock's right once a day.
Twice a day.
Twice a day. See, I was wrong about that.
You're close as hell, though, man.
This is random as hell. It says, Gazbot says, I had a friend who years ago got 50 copies of Space Jam on Laserdisc for $1 each, and he gave them out on Halloween.
It must have been like in a box or something where like they just didn't sell, so somebody had a box of them like from a store or something.
I wonder what the kids closing out when they were handed this big ass. How do I get this home? Can you give this to my pop?
Yeah, there was somebody. I forgot what movie it was, but I saw something, and this guy was trying to collect every VHS copy of some movie. I think it was some bad movie. I forgot what it was, but as many copies as he could possibly get. And he had like this collection of, I forgot what movie it was, but it's kind of funny.
Yeah.
I actually saw The Goonies the other day.
I got tickets to see it, yeah. So they're going to show it, I think, towards the end of the month, and like Corey Feldman's going to be there signing autographs or something, so.
Cool.
And it was only like $5. I'm like, well, hell yeah.
Man. Are you going to get his autograph, like, on your chest or something, get it tattooed?
No, I'm not going to do that. if there's not a line, then I'll get his autograph.
There's no line.
I just don't like standing in line for autographs. But Yeah, if he's just kind of there. I mean, I've got. Then I started thinking because I was at the convention at Phoenix Comic Con. So I'm not really into getting autographs and stuff. But so Sean Astin was there. He obviously played Mikey in Goonies. And then Sam, I was thinking, if I would have got his autograph, because I've got these sketch cards that I did, these Goonies sketch cards. And I was thinking, well, what if I have each, if I could find each member and each have their sign their own, this own sketch card that I did, and maybe frame them or something. I don't know. That would be kind of cool.
But yeah, there you go. Little shrine. So what are they? Why are they putting Goonies out in the theater again or whatever?
They just do that with a lot of classic films. They'll rerun them like on the big screen, and you know. Sometimes they'll, like, it's an anniversary or something, or sometimes, like I said, you know, they'll have one of the people from the movie or something, and then a lot of times, like, if you go to, like, say, like, Alamo Draft House or some of these, like, you know, I don't know what you call it, what kind of theater you would call that, but they show a lot of independent stuff, and they show, like, you know, classic movies, and a lot of times they'll attach it to, like an art print, like somebody will do a cool like a Mondo movie poster or something, and then they you know, you go see it, and then you get the poster, and you get to watch it, and they kind of make an event out of it. So.
Right. And Gaz says, "Have you heard of Monster Squad? You might like that too."
Oh hell yeah, Monster Squad, probably better than Goonies. I don't know if he's asking me, but yeah, Monster Squad is.
He was.
You know, my book's heavily influenced, but okay. Yeah, well, because I only mention it every single, probably every single one of my videos.
It's I've like never Goonies heard of Monster Squad, so.
Oh, you got to see Monster Squad. It's like Goonies, but it's got like Dracula and Frankenstein and the Mummy and the Creature from the Black Lagoon, and it's awesome.
All right, I have to.
Yeah.
Have to look that one up then.
Yeah, it's good.
I just recently seen all the Star Wars.
Oh, Lordy.
So.
You never seen all the Star Wars before now?
No.
Well, your parents, like, abuse you, dude.
I saw episode 1 in theaters when I was a kid.
Yeah, well, sorry about that.
I thought it was badass. Aside from that stupid Gungan. But...
yeah. And then somebody says they're going to make a Goonies sequel? Is that true?
Well, I keep hearing about it, but I don't know. I mean, Richard Donner said that they were going to make it, but I've, you know, you hear stuff like that where they're going to make it, and then something happens and it falls through. So who knows?
I'm actually, yeah, surprised they haven't in a way when you think about it. They've got going after all the other 80 stuff. So
yeah, I just don't know. I don't know if it'd be good. I don't know. It's supposed to be a sequel, not a remake. So, like, I think it's about them. They're grown up, and then they've got their own kids. So
right.
They might be able to do a good job of it. I don't know. It's tough to say.
If they get J.J. Abrams to do it, I'm sure it'll be good.
Well, he already did Super 8. That was about the closest thing, I think, modern that we're going to get to Goonies.
Yeah, Super 8 was awesome.
I still haven't seen that
one. Oh, that's, you got to see that, Jeff.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
I just started thinking to myself, I don't know what the hell I'm going to title this episode because it's just...
Yeah.
But it's cool.
Is that how you guys do it now? You like have a topic, and if it goes off, then...
Yeah, we're not really... If it does go off, as long as it's interesting, we don't care, but we try to come up with a topic to start off with, I think, usually. Just so we're not sitting there like, what do we talk about, you know?
Yeah, I guess I should have told you that before we started.
Yeah, that would have been nice, Jeff.
You could name it DVD, or what's it called, VHS versus Laserdisc.
Well, they won't get it until they get, like, an hour into the episode, though.
Only the true fans.
They won't even care. They'll scroll right by it.
Are you kidding me? This chat was dead until we brought that up. Now it's just, like, rocking. There's got to be a fan base out there, a Laserdisc fan base, that would be ready to get offended over that.
Should release the animation on VHS, man.
That's right.
Creed said, if they wait too long for Goonies 2, it's going to look like Cocoon 3. They're all going to be old.
and then Tim Phillips says, am I a fan of Phil Folio. And also he said, have you read Robert Asprin's Myth Adventures? I've never heard of that one, but I know Phil Folio is. I think he's pretty cool. He's doing like a webcomic now, ain't he? Pretty sure.
What does he do? Does he do stop motion or painting or what?
Comics.
Oh, okay.
I'm sure you've probably seen his stuff. He's done like stuff forever. He actually used to do a lot of like kind of erotic comics and stuff. I'm trying to think of like one title. Can't really think of what his new one is. But yeah, I kind of like his stuff. I think his style's pretty cool. Oh, Girl Genius, that's right. You know what I'm talking about now?
Me? No. I'd probably see, if I saw a picture of it, I'd probably know.
Yeah.
I mean, Girl Genius sounds familiar, but I can't place it.
He's a dude who hits a ton of cons, too. He used to do the comic on the back of Dragon magazine. Tim Phillips says. Alrighty. I think that's a good show.
Yeah, that's good.
I mean, we tackled the Laserdisc versus VHS. What else can we possibly do with this?
I knew going in it was going to be the end of it. How do you top it? You can't. You got to come back fresh.
The show will be back next week. With Kevin. I don't know about Mike, though. No, I'm kidding.
No, thanks for letting me back, man. That was nice.
No, it was actually a lot of fun. It was fun.
Yeah, it was. I actually got some good work in, and it was nice.
Yeah. Well, do you have any website presence? I mean, you want to give out your Snapchat, or you want to keep that secret, or like where can people like find you if they want to?
Instagram and like Snapchat are things that I like update the most regularly. And then Facebook, every once in a while, I'll share whatever I did there if it's good. But I mean, I'm always posting something to Snapchat. Like even just like funny observations I find in life, I'll just, you know. Like a huge fat guy walking a little skinny dog was one of them. I felt like I had to share that with the world. But like Facebook or Instagram right now. And it's just Mike Fleming Jr.
Cool. Gazbot says, is Mike Fleming related to Reed Fleming?
I don't know who that is.
Oh, Fleming Carrot. Reed Fleming, that's what, I get it. He did, that's a comic from back in the day, Fleming Carrot. he totally shot that one way over his head. Scott, what about you, dude? What's your website? Where can the people find you?
Yeah, so you can find me at circworks.com. Circworks pretty much on most of the major social platforms, including Snapchat. So, yeah, look me up on Snapchat. I'm at Circworks because that's the one I'm trying to build up right now the most. So if you're on Snapchat, come check me out.
Cool. And let's see, I'm Jeff Lafferty. There's a mailing list link that's down below the show. If you guys want to get notifications before the show starts every week, just go sign up for that. I won't spam you or nothing, just send a note, you know, 30 minutes before the show starts or something like that. My website's jefflafferty.net, and we'll see you guys next week.